How are you, Joseph?
Well, seeing the circumstances, you know, of I'm okay.
Yeah. Good. Awesome.
Yeah.
So we're here today to talk about open leadership. And you have some awesome experiences as an open leader throughout your career that we want to touch upon in this talk. But one of the first things we want to do is introduce ourselves because as ambassadors to the Open Organization, we don't always get a chance to talk about ourselves. And it's great to know where each of us is coming from and where different ambassadors are coming from because it flavors how we look at the world, what we want to talk about, and our thinking. So it's great to be able to share that and be transparent with our viewers and our readers. So I definitely want to start there today with our discussion.
Oh, that's
So
fine.
awesome. So can I say, please introduce yourself and tell us about you?
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll start to do it briefly because we have some things to talk about it later. But my
Yes.
name is Jos Groen. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm 48 years old. I've got a happy family down here with Carla, my wife, and I've got a twin, so a boy and a girl. They are typical Dutch names, so I'll ask for anyone who speaks native English to try to pronounce them as well. Rein and Lieke. So that's my boy and my girl. They are 17 years old. So that's the one part. Yeah, for me, it's if the subject is about being open. You know, as a kid, I was always wondering, why the hell are we doing things the way we do them? Aren't there other options? Aren't there other ways to achieve the same or to achieve more? And as a child, I learned that from two perspectives. One is that I had severe heart problems. So as a child, I could not play, I could not sport the way other kids played and sport. So I had to figure out other ways, okay, what is possible with what I can do? So my mindset grew to the positive thinking. So let's see what I can do. I know what I can't, but let's see what I can do. So that's a way of thinking, which is very helpful for me in my later career, to transform companies to more open organizations. And the other one is actually that, of course, here in Europe, as well in the rest of the world, we had the World War II, and my grandfather was a very very known from his resistance work in the war. So when I grew up as a little boy and in the young adolescence, well, he told me quite a lot about how I should trust or not trust people, how I should recognize it, how I'll know, okay, this is real and this isn't real. So I got a compass installed within me just to see, okay, this is right, this is wrong, this is okay, this is not okay. And that's the way I learned to look at the world. And after that, I just had a very happy youth, and my heart was okay after 2 years, so I could do everything. So I'm sporting now 3 or 4 times a week, so
Yeah.
the health is okay.
That's awesome.
And you know, I studied economics and marketing, international marketing management. So I jump over to my career after study. Because after study, I did one very nice thing. I traveled for half a year through South America with my current wife. So that was quite a nice experience. Traveling and finding your way every day without any goal every day. So, okay, where are we? What's to do here? So, okay, I could talk hours about that. But then I started working in the field of commerce. So I started on the inside sales, selling educational programs to people, and then I started account management in the IT line of business. So and when I did account management, customers grew bigger, and I got more into the primary processes of the customer. So I got more to the core of the business. And that grew through several companies I worked for, and then I started to realize, you know, that sales is okay, but you know, after one or two conversations, I already know within my system that it will get to a deal. So I thought, it was not very efficient for me to do the other six conversations as well, because I knew if I do this,
You
I get
knew.
the deal. So the
Right.
thrill of getting the deal was not my thrill, you know? It was more in the psychologics of, okay, how does this people, how does this girl or man or professional respond? What do I need to do from belly to belly to get in contact, to get in real contact and just do my work
Right.
there? Just to, you know, not the verbal persuasion, but more on the, you know, there's something
Intuitive
between people
kind
on the
of.
energy level.
Yeah, on the kind of intuitive energy level side.
Yeah, something like
Yeah.
that. And you know, and then I realized, okay, I stopped with the account management. I went into sales management, and in sales management, I got even bored as well after a while. So I had some management levels, and then I started to be management of companies. So then I transferred to a management and consultancy company. You know, I was in the field of IT, so it was quite a switch. And it was a takeover company, so it was 1 year within the big corporate company, and they had all kinds of identity problems. You know, the sales pipeline wasn't in order. They had no perspective where to go to. So I figured out that that was for me. That was quite nice to do, just to help. And just to see, okay, look what happens here, where the energy is, and what is the actual added value of this company. So I just started to develop skills like on that level as a more as a director. And then there was the traveling time from my home to this company, and we got the twins. So it was time to move on, because the traveling time just killed me nearly, and the relation. So I moved on and gone to work for I don't know the English word. So here we go for the first time. It was an installation works. You know, this electrotechnical work they did for other companies, and it was quite a big mess. So it was reorganized. It was just two or three companies were thrown together in a place, and said, okay, just look what happens here. So I got in as a leader, and I had to fight myself through the mess, get the figures back on track. But the main thing was get the people back on track. So they got into trust. And, you know, and that was for me, that was an eye opener for the first time that, okay, as a leader, it's more about trust than about control. You know, building control is not that hard, but building trust within a company where everyone is angry at you or at the company because, you know, management just took everything away from them as they experience it. You have to gain trust back. So I did that, and then I moved on to an earthing and lightning protection company. I had to do quite some reorganization there. So it was change to get the identity back into the company. But in after 2-3 years, figures were going up, and in the fourth year, figures never had gotten better. So then I learned, okay, there's something other you do than the other people around me. So it was not management, it was more about leadership. And then I transferred to my last job, in which I'm now. And I found in Axians, one of the labels of Vinci Energies, a worldwide company. I found some core values in which I could build more of what I know now. It's more the open organization. So through my journey, I did quite a little, a lot of different types of companies in different markets with different mindsets. And the main thing there was I had to transform them from the thing it was into a more open organization. So it functions well, and it's more in a more organic way. So people know what they need to do. They don't need me to do things. No, that's the big perspective shift I learned from that. So I hope it's short enough, but it's quite
And I want to ask about that being a director of that company where you found that the people really lacked trust in leaders. And I'm struck by that because I'm thinking that probably without that incredible imbalance, because you talk about a balance in some of your work, you talk about a balance between people and business. And without that incredible imbalance, you wouldn't have seen, you would not have maybe tried to build the trusting relationships as much, right? Because you might have, or you or another leader might have just said, oh yeah, the people are fine the way they are, let's just work on the business. But because there was that huge imbalance, you had to do both. And it seems like it really shaped, the work that you did afterwards, because you could so clearly see the problem.
Yeah, but to be honest, I lived through the problem already quite a lot of times in the
Oh
earlier
yeah.
career because I had management and they were asking me to give every week an update on the business and on this and on that. And I thought, okay, but what does a week make a difference in the long-term goal?
Yeah,
You know,
true.
and I got bored, sick and tired of all these management questions. I thought, oh, I don't think they're relevant. You know, I'm here for the big picture, and you know, this is where I'm heading at. So yeah, if 1 week is different than another, that's okay, and you can have your figures, but you know, don't put the emphasis on it. Just give me space, just give me trust, give me trust to do my thing so I can bring my creativity. You know, I can bring my leadership skills into place just to enhance everything, you know, you work on. So later on, when I was more a director, I learned that it was not only about business. You know, it's more about people because the human essence is the thing you have to work with. You know, the people are the most important asset in your company. So if there's no trust, and if you don't are if you don't have any sincere intention to be the person you are, and that the other can be the person he or she is within your company, you know, there's no basis for creativity or hard work or intrinsic motivation, stuff like that. It all starts there. And as a leader, you have to do quite a lot of things. You have to bring a lot of energy. You have to see, okay, sometimes you need change, you know, you have to push things through to get things working. And sometimes you just have to foster transformation, or you just have to, you know, you have to be there and see, okay, this is willing to happen. Okay, I'm gonna support it so we can let it happen. So, you know,
And
in the translation company, you know, that's all people with short-term focus, but they, you know, they felt it might seem a bit strange, but they felt a kind of love again, to love each other, to love
yeah.
themselves. But you know, we are here for a certain purpose, and that's not only gain profit. You know, we have a bigger picture here.
Yeah, there's meaning to be gotten. And so in your when you're describing some of this stuff, I'm hearing the connection between, who your kind of internal compass that you were experienced as a kid, right? The challenge to how things are, the why, and the asking why not this instead, right? I hear that. And I hear a little bit of your grandfather trying to help you learn people skills, right? I mean, think when you think of like before we were talking and before we recorded, we said, okay, you and I were talking, we were saying, hey, we're just going to answer the questions how we answer them. And that's wonderful because that indicates what's top of mind, right? Your grandfather's top of mind was to teach you people skills. Amazing, right? Like how many times you sit down with your grandkid and go, all right, here's how you work with people.
No, because you know, I spent a lot of time with him, and he really learned me the value of trust. You know,
Trust.
because when you're in a war
Authenticity.
situation, the lack of trust is big, but you have to trust a very small group of people in which you are within the resistance, you know? So his compass was very fine on trusting people, who to
Who to
trust and
trust and who not to,
who
why,
do,
when, and what it looked
yeah.
like. And yeah. I
So
was
I
thinking
think he
about
put a lot of that into me. So it was not a fear, but it's more like, okay, just be keen on which people you're working with.
It matters. It matters
Yeah.
because you get a real connection. And something I've been thinking about in my in just some stuff going on in my own life is like how when you make yourself vulnerable, you make yourself stronger because you're connecting with someone else when you have that trust and you're vulnerable. that connection makes you stronger. And so, it's kind of funny because you think, oh, being vulnerable makes me weaker. And it's like, no, not when you're in a, not when you can connect with someone you trust. That makes you stronger. And that's like what you're kind of talking about in some of the articles you write about, greater than the sum of the parts, right? It's not just pieces and parts of people, but those trustful connections and authentic connections between us all that can really make or break your organization.
Yes, quite a good reading there.
I pay attention.
I couldn't emphasize it better. You know, but there's one other thing to it, and it's not only for the case we're talking about, but I experienced it in the last few years as well, because I'm a director within a huge corporate company with very good core values. But you still see hierarchical structures, you still see authority, you still see management. And if you want to build an open organization as a leader for your team, you have to deal with both sides of the world. You know, you have to function as well as a manager, talking the talk the directors want to hear, and on the other hand, you have to be the open leader to your team. And one thing I learned, I think it's in the earthing and the lightning protection company, I learned that, you know, I didn't have to be the guy who knew most. You know, normally when you are a director, you have more data, you have more information than other people. So that enables you to be the guy who makes the decisions to create the big picture. And in that company, I learned the more of this data and information I give back to my people and to the right people, you know, they can do with the data they need to do as well. But it really empowered them just to move forward, just to make the decisions. They didn't need me for that work. So that was quite an eye-opener for me. You know, I don't have to be the guy which has to take every decision or has to be in every conversation or, you know, I'm just there to support them to take their responsibility and the response the things they are responsible for. You know, it's quite a shift in my opinion how I look in at my work. And somewhere down there it happened. You know, that I thought, oh, it's not about me, it's about them. Just helping them to get to do what they do best.
Yeah, and I think that's a little what I see missing sometimes in conventional organizations is the idea that leaders are don't have to be the experts, they don't have to have the vision, right? They need to like I don't I want I'll just say they have to kind of facilitate or coordinate or yes, they have to break ties of opinions among their senior leaders or whatever, but it's much more nuanced than a straight up you're the boss. It is no more, it's not like that anymore. It's not command and control. It's collaboration. And that really resonated in a lot of what you were saying. And I kind of feel like sometimes calling organizations that use our five values of openness, calling them open organizations are is so confusing. I like to start thinking of it like a communal organization. Right, because it's like that immediately implies that the members of the organization have a stake in that organization, and that's kind of what the one of the major changes in leadership that you're talking about, from what I from my perspective, that's how I interpret it.
Of course, and I think you have quite a good vision on that point. You know, it's you go and work for a company because there's a higher cause you want to serve. You know, and as a leader, you have to be able just to get the best ideas upward, just to listen to them and just say, okay, you're working for the higher cause. Let's see what's the main cause we are all attracted to, or we are all intrinsically motivated by, and just enhance it, you know. But it has to be about and passion and performance, you know. There has to be, here it comes, balance in your company, because it, you know, when I started to build the more on the principles of the open organization in work I'm doing now, people thought, okay, we have to agree in everything together, you know, and it's what one big open discussion. I said, no, 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 okay. You know, sometimes I have to do something autonomous, and sometimes we have to do it together, you know, but that's the balance the leader creates. And there must be hierarchy, you know, there must be some guy or girl who's taking the decisions. Mm-hmm. You know, it's more about having the conversations, having the disagree within your team, just to talk, okay, are we on the same page here? You know, and that's all mm-hmm. about getting commitment, getting mm-hmm. to commute, getting to collaborate.
Yeah, I think it's really easy for some people to really want to, you know, over-rotate on one or the other. It's all about, you know, for a long time, I think we've had the over-rotation on, it's all about business, you know, and it's not about people. And but it can't be all about people either, because if you're not making good business decisions, you're not staying in operation, and then you're firing everyone because there's no money to pay anybody.
Yeah.
So it's like... Very pragmatic, but yeah, it is about that balance. It's hard, I think, for a lot of people to balance like that. Not everybody's able to kind of stay in that middle and kind of oscillate between the two poles of business and people, but it's really, really important to do that. So
yeah,
go ahead.
No, I think as a leader, you know, there's something we have to realize, that we have a certain conditioning to do things the way we do it, you know, and sometimes you see behavioral patterns, or you see behavior from leaders or directors or managers. You say, okay, you're taught to do this, but are you really a person to do this? You know,
mm-hmm.
there's
mm-hmm.
something about sincerity. Are you honestly doing this, or is it just because you do a trick because mm-hmm. you learn to?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the eagle eye of people is definitely always there. So they know if you do something from a sincere perspective or not. And as a leader, there's it's quite good to realize it for yourself, that, okay, mm-hmm. people look at me that way. And trust is about being honest, being sincere, you know, being transparent. Let inclusivity take place, you know, mm-hmm. being vulnerable. And you can be vulnerable as a leader if you have an inner balance as well. And I think the major challenge for a lot of conventional leaders is to do their inner work first before they get in another balance, so they can do the transformation or open organization leadership as well.
Mm-hmm. That's a really, really interesting thing.
Yeah, but maybe another time we can deliberate more on that.
Yeah, definitely. I wanted to ask you one more question before we end. You know, in the beginning, we talked about how your roles have changed over time, and you mentioned how you in your kind of like more recent career, you learned that leaders facilitate, they create that context. What are some of the other things that you saw change from role to role as you managed more or different parts of the organization, right? I'm very interested in that progression, because when you're a manager of individual contributors, you meet with them frequently, you're working very closely with them, the decisions that you're making are very impactful on that team. And then as you move, you have your decisions are different, they're impactful at different levels for different reasons. I'm kind of just curious, like how did transparency, inclusivity change for you? Or was it always, looking back, always about making that context?
Yeah, I think that a lot of things I do and how I'm looking to situations or drama, you know, is about, okay, asking the question, do I need to do something here? Do I need to solve it for the short term? Or do I have to learn something from what's happening now and just take it to me and say, okay, what can I do? How can I facilitate this? What is willing to happen here? You know, and then I did a lot of work, and I think it's more in the recent years, I think 5 or 6 years ago, I got more into transformation, the transformational presence. So I learned more about, okay, if everything is energy, you know, I can put a lot of energy into things, but if the team is not ready for it, or I don't get them to be with this energy, nothing is going to happen. So it is always a process of trial and error. So I tried to put a lot of change in the company, and I thought, okay, change is not going to work, at least not the way I want to do it, because people are not involved. You don't get them empowered. They don't. I learned that a lot of things you want to achieve is not a push on a button. It's not, okay, I think this is the best way forward, so let's go the best way forward. And if you have 40, 50 people looking at you, okay, nice that you think it, but you know, that's not quite inclusive.
Right.
But I learned only in, you know, in the last 4 years from this IT company I work for now, I learned Red Hat. And already in the first year, we said goodbye to IBM and said hello to Red Hat, you know. And now in time, things have changed, as we all know. But some Red Hat heard about my opinion on my work and thought, okay, it would be nice if you read the book of Jim, The Open Organization. So I read it, and I read it quite, I think, two or three times in a row just to tick all the boxes and said, well, what we are talking now is a framework. You know, I love, but it's so close to who I am. And I started to recognize the shifts I made, you know?
Right.
For example, in one of the companies, you could not share any information on results or turnover or, you know, the production you did. You know, that was not done. And when I started doing this, you know, I got my management team and my director's team falling over me, you know, it's not done that you do it. And I thought, well, let's see what happens here. So I brought it to the people and started to sharing it. And they said, whoa, you know, they got far more involved with the decisions we were taking. They said, okay, but if this is the problem, as we can interpret it as well as you do, you know, maybe this is a solution. You know, I got ideas back from the team just by starting to share information. But I was serving a company where it was not done, or it was not usual, at least. You know, and if you ask me, okay, what kinds of shift did you notice? These were some of the small details in shifts which made huge impact on the teams I was leading. And I still, you know, in my current job, when I started there, it was quite a mess as well, mentally and physically, and on the turnover and result. But the first thing I did was say, okay, hey guys, it's not about me down here. I'm here to help you. I'm here to serve you, and let's open up. So that was quite the first team I started with. So I started to share everything. You know, there's no individual purpose here. We have a commutual purpose here. So it's about collaboration, you know, and then you learn from being with people in a one-to-one or in a group or in a one-to-any. You know, I started to involve the people more like I'd ever did before in the decision taking, in the ideas, in the ideas getting to me and giving energy back. So there, I think that was the point that I learned, okay, if I bring more transparency, if I get to inclusivity, if I get more emphasis on collaboration, build upon trust and a safe environment, you know, you have to be who you want to be. You can have to say what you want to say, you know, and we don't have to fight over it. We can respect each other's opinion. And when people started to feel that was one of the purposes I was bringing in, you know, there you start to build trust.
Yeah. That's cool. That must have been really neat to see that change.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, and that's what's really what I told before. You know, if you get a deal, you can get glad. But if you see people smile on the face or say, okay, you know, I understand what's going on here and I can enjoy it. You know, if you see more joy in your team, you know, that's what makes it worth to wake up and say, okay, I've got a lot of energy to give, so I'll give it right away because this is the higher purpose to bring it to.
Yeah, that makes a lot. That makes a really big difference in the lives of employees, right? Because Just from that innovation perspective too, when we're not stressed or when employees aren't stressed out, when they can find meaning and some good positive connection to their work, that frees up the mental space to be creative. It's incredibly draining to be creative. It's hard, right? And you don't get into a flow like that easily. You have to be in what I call wise mind, where you're not hyperactive and you're not hypoactive, being depressed. You're not depressed and you're not stressed. It's like in that
Yeah.
middle wise mind, right? Where
Yeah,
you
it's about
that's where
flow.
flow can where that's where flow can happen. So that's really, really cool, and it really resonates with me. We're gonna end this interview, and but we'll be back, and we'll with round two with Joe's Growing.
Okay,
So stay tuned.
happy to do so.
Awesome.
Thank you.